Good morning, beautiful people, and welcome to Pleasant Hill as we join our hearts and our souls and our minds and we prepare them for an encounter with the living God.
Today, we are going to talk about doing good. Monica and Alan, they're going to be on a 3 weeks of, first week was do no harm, this week's do good, and then third week stay in love with God. They all kind of go together, but they all kind of work together really, really seamlessly. But these are what John Wesley said. He started the Methodist Church, you know, where we go. And So this week is do good. Now that's a pretty simple rule, ain't it? I like it. I like it a lot. Just do good. One of my favorite things about my job as a fireman is that's what we do. All we do is try to do good by people and try to help people. When I first got hired a long time ago, an older guy said that our whole job is just summed up in just helping people. Help people. That's what he said. If you go on calls, help people. Help them. Whatever they need, help them. And that always kind of resonated with me. I thought, that's really, really good. That's the whole reason we're there, just to help them. It could be a snake in the house, help them get it out. It could be somebody's having a bad, bad medical event. Well, we're supposed to help them and make things better. So, so that do good really kind of resonates with me. From my job standpoint and just from what he said to me a long time ago. But it's a really, really simple rule, so I like that. Just do good. Do good by your parents. Do good by your own self, your body. Do good by your friends. Do good when nobody's watching. Do what's right. And it's a simple, simple rule. Do good. And if you do good, you're doing what God wants. You're going to do it what God loves, and we're honoring God. So I hate to say it, but really, that's all I got. Do good. It's hard sometimes, but that's what we're supposed to do. So take care of folks, love folks, treat them right, and do good. All right, all the time. Let's pray right quick, all right? Dear God, thank you for loving us, and help us to love each other like you love us, and help us to do good by everybody we encounter, and to do good by ourselves, and help us to honor you, and help us to honor ourselves, help us honor our families by doing good. We thank you for everything that you do for us. We love you. Amen.
Well, Father God, hear our prayers. Hear our prayers as we lift to you our own personal needs, those needs that sometimes, well, they just seem too petty or private or painful to share. Oh God, remember those that we are aware of who are sick or suffering in any way. Remember those who are grieving. Remember our community, our nation, and our world as we all grieve and eagerly await that new heaven, that new earth, that new creation where all harm will be done away with. Father God, hear our prayers and move us to be your hands and your feet, to be your voice, to be your eyes, to be your ears, to be your heart as we help you bring healing to this hurting world. As we come to you this morning, as always, we come here to express our praise and our awe for you through each song that we sing, each word that we speak, even the very thoughts that we harbor in our hearts and our minds. And we pray as we offer these as gifts of praise to you that in some way we might bless you. So be with us this morning. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and join our voices and our hearts together as we pray the very prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We are strong.
So this morning, we're continuing our series that revolves around John Wesley's three simple rules. Do no harm, do good, stay in love with God. And once again, this week, we'll be looking at those three rules through that familiar parable of the Good Samaritan found in the 10th chapter of Luke, beginning in verse 25. An expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself." Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to vindicate himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and took off, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came upon him, and when he saw him, he was moved with compassion. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, treating them with oil and wine. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Shall we pray? Well, Father God, in the next few moments, we pray that you would once again, breathe your living spirit upon these words and use these words to melt us and mold us and shape us into the very likeness of Jesus Christ, so that you might use us to do good in this world. For it's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Three simple rules to live by. Do no harm, do good, stay in love with God. And how beautifully these rules are illustrated in that parable of the Good Samaritan. First, do no harm. In the parable, we see many different ways in which that traveler who was traveling all alone on that lonely road, we see all of the ways in which that traveler was caused harm. First, we see it in those bandits, those thieves. It wasn't an uncommon occurrence in Jesus' day. They would wait around a bend, wait where the path widened, and they would attack a vulnerable traveler. It was as common as many of the acts of violence that we see today. Those bandits cause him harm by beating him and attacking him and stealing all of his possessions and then leaving him on the road half dead. We can all see how that is causing someone harm, right? You know, I'm proud to say this morning that I don't believe there is a single one of us here at Pleasant Hill that would intentionally cause harm to anyone. We certainly wouldn't attack someone. None of us would commit an act of violence against someone. None of us would abuse a child or carry out a mass shooting. There's not a single one of us who would want to take what didn't belong to us, to steal it from someone else. There's not a single one of us in this room that would attack someone, that would beat someone, that would leave them half dead. And not a single one of us this morning that would, you know, take food from a starving child or commit any harmful act intentionally against anyone else. I think that's pretty safe to say this morning. See, those are what we call in the church sins of commission. Sins that require us to think, and sins that require us to plan, and sins that require us to use our strength, our physical being, to carry something out that will harm someone else or bring harm, in a sense, to God. There's very few of us that would carry out any sin of commission. But you know, as you read the parable, that's not the only way in which this man had been harmed, is it? It tells us that day that by chance a priest comes walking down that road and he sees the man lying there half dead, and it says that he passes him by on the other side. See, the priest, wasn't responsible for what had happened, was he? He didn't attack the man. He didn't beat the man. He didn't rob the man of his possessions. He's not the one that left that man dead on the side of the road. And yet, the harm he causes by just passing the man by? Well, a lot of folks would say that was just as harmful as the act and the sin of commission that had been carried out against that traveler. It goes on to say that a little while later, you know, a Levite, another holy man of God, comes walking down that path, and it too says that upon seeing him, he just passes by on the other side. You see, there's two types of sins. Two types of sins that cause, in my opinion, equal harm. There's those sins of commission, like we just talked about, carried out by those bandits. And then there's sins of omission. Those sins that come as a result of seeing someone in this world, in a sense, lying half dead on the other side of the road and just passing by and doing absolutely nothing. Well, I just said, I don't think there's a single one of us this morning that would carry out a harmful act intentionally, that would intentionally commit a sin of omission. I can't say that same thing when it comes to sins of omission. The sins of passing a hurting person or a hurting person by, just leaving them on the side of the road. You see, I can say that with all confidence because, well, I commit those sins of omission more than I want to admit. What was it? Why was it that both the priest, a godly man, and the Levite, a godly man, they just passed that victim and passed them by, leaving them to continue to die on the side of that road? And Monica touched on it last week. You know, this priest and this Levite, this lawyer that had just talked to Jesus, this Pharisee. Well, they had these 613 religious laws. Well, they had these 613 religious rules. And in order for that priest to stop and that priest to do something, in order for that Levite to stop, in order for that Levite to do something, it's going to require that they break one of those, actually, many of those 613 religious laws, 613 religious rules, namely those when it comes to laws of cleanliness and uncleanliness. I guess they pass them by because those 613 religious laws, those 613 religious rules, well, they're more important than a person lying half dead on the side of the road. The same set of religious laws, the same set of religious rules that would have allowed that priest and that Levite to stop on a Sabbath and get a donkey out of a ditch, but wouldn't allow them to stop and help this man. Something's wrong with that, don't you think? And then the scripture says that by chance a Samaritan traveling came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. It doesn't stop there. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, "Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend." Wow. His doing good seems to have no end. That second simple rule: do good. Do what is good. Now you need to understand that the Samaritan is really no different than the priest and the Levite. That when the Samaritan comes down that road and his heart is filled with compassion, and you know, maybe the priest and the Levite had compassion as well, you realize he has to break certain rules, certain laws in order to help this Jewish man lying half dead on the side of the road. You all know the prejudice and the hatred that existed between Jews and Samaritans. Ironically, Jews and Samaritans that worshiped the very same God, that had the very same ancestors. And, you know, they would travel miles out of the way just not to step on Samaritan land, or vice versa, travel miles out of the way not to step on Jewish land. The two very seldom mixed. Yeah, I've talked about legal laws. I've talked about religious laws. You know, even more powerful than laws that are on a government's books or laws that are in a book of discipline for believers in Christ, even more powerful than that, I think, are the cultural laws that we enforce in our families and we enforce in our communities. You know, this Samaritan, it could have been justified if he left that man dying on the side of the road. It could have been justified if he would have held fast to the cultural laws that said these two people, well, they never mix. These two people, they just, you know, have nothing to do with one another. These two people owe nothing to the other people. You know, this Samaritan has to throw those rules and throw those laws out the window in order to help this man. What would you say if I told you that sometimes to do good, sometimes to do what God is calling us to do, it means that we break certain rules, that maybe we break certain laws, that we have to throw these things and cast things off to the side in order to do what God says is right, in order to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our soul, and with all our strength. You know, after the first week of this series, Keith Abercrombie came to me and shared with me a beautiful story that revolved around Judge Dan Reynolds. Dan, who was one of the Abbas, one of the respected father figures in our church family. And Keith explained what we all knew, that Dan was one of the most revered and respected men when it came to the profession of law. That Dan was, in a sense, created to sit on a bench and to exercise godly wisdom in his judgment. Well, Keith said that they were teaching their son Keith to drive. He was about 15 years old. And at the time, this road out in front of the church, Bell Hill Road, well, it was being moved and it was being changed, and there was a lot of construction going on. And there was a 15 mile an hour speed limit that had been put in place. Well, the Abercrombies had taught their son to always obey the law, and as he's learning to drive, to strictly adhere to all of those laws. So the young man was driving 15 miles an hour down Bell Hill Road. Keith talks about how that was just this line of cars, this pile of cars that began to pile up behind his son, and they were getting angry, and they were blowing their horns and other things. And as they were pulling into the church, everyone, it seemed, that passed just begins to blow their horns or make some sort of ugly sign or, you know, express their anger. So when they came in, Keith sat there with Judge Reynolds. And he says, I have a question for you. And he told him the situation, what had just happened. And he says, Judge, I don't imagine that you were driving 15 miles an hour down Bell Hill Road this morning, to which he said the judge responded, probably not, but knowing Judge Reynolds, he just might have. And Keith asked him, well, what do you do? What do you do when you're trying to teach your children to adhere to all of these laws? Judge Reynolds, Dan, said, well, that's kind of the challenge of parenting. The challenge of teaching our children to respect and honor the law while using common sense when it comes to adhering to those laws. That takes us back, doesn't it? It takes us back to that lawyer who comes before Jesus, that lawyer trying to live out, respect, and adhere to all 613 of those religious laws, and he asked Jesus, what do I really have to do in order to inherit eternal life? And Jesus knows that he knows the answer, because the answer is common sense. Anyone, whether they were a teacher of the law, an expert of the law, a lawyer, anyone in that multitude that day could have answered that question. Jesus says, you know the answer. Tell me. And using common sense, the lawyer says, well, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Beautiful people, when it comes to do no harm, do good, it's just good old godly common sense. And it's as simple as that. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
through the wind and flame, I will tear.